We are 146 days from the glory of Elden Ring, and the hype is at an all-time high. This is Ghost Riposte, and we finished our Soulsborne plus Sekiro boss ranking series, except for the Sekiro mini-bosses, which will drop next week, so I thought this would be a perfect time to get some Elden Ring talk in. The links to all those countdowns are in the description. We're taking a look at the top 10 things I hope to see in FromSoftware's absurdly anticipated title. A number of these may be controversial topics, but I'll do my best to provide sound reasoning and give the opposite side of each entry. Most of these aren't deal breakers, but just some fun things to talk about while we wait. One caveat, I'm doing my best to go into Elden Ring as blind as possible and have only seen the trailer, so it's possible there's information pertaining to items on the list I'm simply not aware of. Side note, if anyone is interested, tomorrow morning or afternoon for my friends across the ocean, I'm going to be streaming my first attempt at a Soul Level 1 run, which I'm going to try with Demon Souls as I think this is probably my most realistic shot out of all the Souls games. It'll be right here on the channel, so if you want to laugh at my attempt, root me on, or just hang out and talk Souls or any other game, drop on by. Also, I never ask this because I know it's kind of annoying, but go ahead and subscribe if you like the content, remember to hit like, and maybe leave a comment saying what you'd like to see in Elden Ring, as it does help the channel out. In no particular order, let's get right into it. Photo mode. I thought it would be best to ease into the list with the least controversial entry. I can't imagine anyone disliking the photo mode integrated into Demon's Souls. As far as I'm aware, there's no photo mode in any other prior FromSoftware games, or at least not one as comprehensive and functional as the Demon's Souls remake version, which was made by Bluepoint, so there's no guarantee photo mode will be included. Yes, you can use it to cheat a little bit in PvP, but even that has a funny side to it, and I can't think of a substantial reason to not include it. I have no clue how easy it is to code or develop a photo mode, but I'd love to see one in Elden Ring, and I think you probably would too. Roaming boss or enemy? Although the hype is real for Elden Ring and the concept of an open world FromSoftware game is exciting to no end, I'm anticipating the feel of the game to be more along the lines of Dark Souls 1 rather than truly open world like Red Dead Redemption 2 or Skyrim. And that's totally fine. Maybe it's me just trying to temper expectations a little bit. Who would dislike a modernized Dark Souls 1? I know I would love it. The reason I'm thinking about this is that open world games generally have a level of randomized enemy generation. The same number of enemies and types don't always generate in the same spots, whereas in FromSoftware games, the exact enemies always spawn in the exact locations, and once you kill them, are dead until you die or reset the world in some way. What would fit perfectly in an open world game would be a roaming boss similar to the Pursuer, or Forlorn in Dark Souls 2, that you could come across in any location at any time. While the Pursuer's appearances are fixed, perhaps this boss could pop up randomly at some point in the game. I realize this would be an absolute nightmare for challenge runners, but I think this would work perfectly in an open world setting. It wouldn't necessarily appear multiple times like the Pursuer, but imagine the anticipation and tenseness as you explore the world on any given playthrough knowing, crap, that roaming boss still hasn't shown up yet. I think it would add a good level of anticipation to exploration. Boss Rush Mode. This was another no-brainer given the success of the Sekiro Boss Rush Mode in the form of reflections and gauntlets. Who doesn't love testing their skills in a gauntlet versus the biggest, baddest foes in the game, taking out monster after monster like a complete badass? I can't see a reason for not having a boss rush mode available upon completing the main game. Maybe you could say a boss rush mode inhibits the desire to replay the whole game when the bosses are already made available, but I think people who would play a boss rush mode would probably replay the game regardless. Balance to PvP or just good PvP in general? In voicing this video today, I realized Wexdust would be an amazing addition to an open-world Souls game, but I'll have to save that for another video. This is most likely the entry that's going to upset people in some way, and probably have the widest range of opinions, as the topic of PvP and invasions usually does. Much of the consternation in regards to Souls PvP comes from the misunderstanding of the intention of PvP in Souls games, and newer players trying to force their previous experiences with multiplayer onto the Souls format of multiplayer. And this coming from someone who was terrified for years to actually switch my mode into online, having now fallen in love with PvP in Souls games. That being said, I'm going to try and be as unbiased as possible. As far as I'm aware, the exact details and function of PvP in Elden Ring still seem to be somewhat unclear. There seems to be some information today that solo hosts will only be invaded once summoning, which I actually enjoy the anticipation of an invader while playing solo. That information doesn't appear to be confirmed yet, however. Apparently, there will be certain regions or areas where you can PvP, and I've seen Miyazaki mention in an interview there will definitely be invasions, but PvP will be optional, and mentioned they are trying their best to make PvP less annoying for both players. I assume this means less annoying for invaders running into constant disconnects, and non-PvPers not having to deal with constant invasions, the argument of online versus simply switching to offline aside. I do take these with a grain of salt, as a number of these interviews have been translated through multiple languages and contain vague details to begin with. It still seems like this could mean anything from simply playing offline, to PvP being specific to certain areas as mentioned, to PvP being specific to certain covenants in a similar fashion to previous titles. I think the question non-PvPers really would like to know is, can I summon friends without being invaded? Which, on evidence of past Souls games, I'd be surprised if that was implemented. I will say, perhaps there should be some sort of out for players simply trying to view messages and phantoms that don't want to be invaded with the scraping spear and acid cloud and have all their equipment broken an hour into the game. Maybe a limited use item so as to not have to put a spell such as Banish on every build simply to deal with overly excited invaders. Granted, FromSoftware has done a much better job scaling back troll weapons in later games, as far as I could tell, although I'd be lying if I said they weren't fun to use every once in a while. Either way, hopefully Elden Ring has a PvP format that works for the majority of players. New Game Plus Enhancement. This one is probably only going to be specific to hardcore Souls players, as I realize the majority of players only run through a game once and not 17 times. A great addition would be some sort of enhancement to New Game Plus cycles, perhaps more rewards, additional enemies, varied placements, something to upgrade the experience as bounty for venturing into multiple cycles of New Game Plus, as simply running a game 6-7 times with the exact same build can get tedious. One topic for this video could have been stat reallocation, which is an entire game design discussion unto itself, but perhaps upon completion of a new game cycle, you could rework your build as you have completed the game and want to take it up a notch, but may not want to necessarily run the game 7 times with the exact same build. FromSoftware has had rewards here and there in New Game Plus cycles, especially Dark Souls 2 previously, but I would love to see more of this in Elden Ring. Short boss runs. Is there anything more demoralizing or frustrating than coming agonizingly close to defeating a difficult boss, only to have to fight through an army of common enemies again? If we're judging by FromSoftware's most recent game, Sekiro, we should be in for short strolls as the majority of Sculptor's idols are placed generously close to bosses. In the right context, I understand a long boss run. I can see arguments for it, as in Demon's Souls and other older games where the bosses aren't tremendously difficult for the most part and serve as the gate at the end of a linear level, but I would imagine in an open world context, most checkpoints will be relatively close to the bosses. I know some of you hardcore old school gamers aren't necessarily fond of checkpoints right outside boss areas, but I look at it as this: the closer the bonfire, the harder and more complex you can get away with developing the boss, as players won't grow as agitated dealing with a more difficult challenge when they can make frequent attempts at it. Mini bosses. One of the highlights of Sekiro was the inclusion of a variety of excellent mini bosses. This added a lot of depth and fun to the world. For example, Armored Warrior was one of the most memorable enemies in all of Sekiro. Speaking of, next weekend the Sekiro mini boss rankings will be dropping if anyone is interested, so keep an eye out for that. Other Souls games have had a version of mini bosses, as the sharks in the Pit of Doom in Bloodborne were essentially a mini boss, with Lady Maria's Rikuyo being the reward. The Titanite demons in Dark Souls are in essence a mini boss. Solavon's beast that guards the bridge to Irithyll of the Boreal Valley in Dark Souls 3 as well is a mini boss of sorts. So each game has had tougher enemies that weren't fully fledged bosses. It would just be nice to have a few more defined challenges that test different skills leading up to the main boss, as in Sekiro. For example, Headless and the Shishimen Warriors, forced you to learn how to circumvent the terror status, while Armored Warrior and the Centipedes taught you repeated parry timing. I realize this entry isn't totally defined, as there will always be tougher enemies that aren't bosses per se, but the structured nature of my brain just appreciated the more defined nature of mini-bosses in Sekiro. Soul or Echo Recovery? I'd like to see Soul or Echo Recovery make a return, as it gives a nice layer of control and tension back to the player. I was never a fan of the randomized nature of recovery in Sekiro in the form of unseen aid. Who am I to question Miyazaki, but I've always found good game design to err on the side of the player controlling their fate. I thought Bloodborne built on the soul recovery mechanic nicely, with the possibility of an enemy picking up your souls adding a layer of suspense as you rewalked your steps to try and recover those elusive echoes. That may not work in the context of Elden Ring, depending on how enemies are laid out in the open world format, but at the very least, the control for recovering should be in the hands of the player, and not simply waiting to see if unseen aid comes through or automatically losing half of your stash. I realized less deaths meant higher unseen aid probability, but there was always some level of randomness I wasn't necessarily a fan of. Unique mix of atmosphere or environments? Now, I understand part of what makes Soul's environment special is the bleak and dreary nature, but I don't think that means the entire game needs to be in grayscale. Obviously, I'm exaggerating, as Sekiro had Fountainhead Palace, Dark Souls 1 had Anne Orlando, Dark Souls 2 had Eliam Lois, Dark Souls 3 had Irithyll of the Boreal Valley, and Bloodborne had Forsaken Castle Cainhurst. Being a massive open-world game, a nice mix of environments is likely, and based on the trailer, it does look like a decent array of color palettes may be present. I'm not saying the game should be Super Mario World, but Elden Ring could retain a secluded, dreary nature and still have a mix of unique environments to traverse. Compendium or Bestiary? This is a tricky one, as one of the main staples of a Souls game is seeking out the lore and story through various locations, interactions, dialogue, weapon descriptions, and so on. So, a compendium or bestiary would have to be done in such a way that fits within the structure of a Souls game without diluting the lore. Maybe what I'm really looking for is just an organized layout in the menu where you can read the lore you have interacted with in the game up to any given point. Perhaps this could even involve a quest with an NPC to avoid breaking immersion too much. This one isn't a deal breaker, but top 10 sounds a whole lot better than top 9. Thank you as always for stopping by. As I said, tomorrow morning or afternoon, for my friends on the other side of the ocean, I'll be attempting my first Soul Level 1 run in Demon Souls if anyone wants to hang out and talk Souls, root me on, or just laugh at my attempt. Otherwise, I'll see you guys next week with the Sekiro mini-boss rankings. This has been Ghost Riposte. Peace.
Farewell, good hunter. May you find your worth in the waking world.